What's up, guys? Welcome back to my channel. I have with me here Ricardo. A lot of you guys already know who he is. You guys have seen him on quite a few of my live streams in the past. And as a lot of you guys already know, Ricardo is Haitian. So we will be speaking on just some of the current stuff happening on the island of Hispaniola, as well as just getting into some of Ricardo's background. So Ricardo, thank you for meeting up with me. We are currently here in Washington, D.C. So this is my first meetup of the DMV. I definitely want to meet up with some more of you guys that are here in the D.C., Maryland, Virginia, metropolitan area. So again, thank you for coming out. So Ricardo, tell us a little bit about your family background. Where in Haiti is your family from, and just how did y'all get here?
All right, so a little bit about my background. My family is from Tiguave, Haiti. My mom came here in the mid-80s, and she came here by boat. Her and my aunt, you know, risked their lives to come here by boat.
Wow. Okay. And your father, did he also...
My dad is from Gonaïve, and he also came here by boat also. He came in the early 80s.
Okay, so that's similar to my parents. My parents came to the U.S. In the 80s. They didn't come by boat, but they came through, you know, marrying other people. You know, that was a big business back in the day. So, you know, they married their people, got divorced, and then they married each other. So, I know that you've been to Haiti, right?
Multiple times.
Okay, and the last time you went was a few years ago?
Yes.
So tell us about your experience in Haiti. How do you compare it to the United States? And just what did you see while you were there? Because, you know, outside of Haiti, we're painted a very specific picture of Haiti as being this very poor, destitute country, and everyone just living in shambles. But how was your experience there? What did you see while you were there?
Okay, my experience in Haiti was one of happiness and sadness at the same time. Like, I seen a lot of, like, Haiti has a lot of untapped natural beauty. Mm. Like, we have the mountains, you have the clear water, beautiful people, but you also have the reality of, you know, Haiti's a poor country, so there's poor people.
Yeah.
So, it's a beautiful country. And every time I was in Haiti, especially when I was in the capital, I was looking at everything I could fix. I don't know if that makes sense, so, like, if I seen something wrong, I was like, man, if I had the money or I had the power, I would fix that. But all in all, it's an island. Islands are beautiful. But with Haiti's infrastructure, especially because of the 2010 earthquake, Haiti needs a lot of help.
Basically. Yeah. So in your opinion, what do you think has contributed to Haiti just being in this, like, continual state of turmoil, which it seems like it just can never get out of? What do you think has contributed to that, either historically or in the present?
Well, if you look at Haiti historically, when Haiti gained its independence, it was the first black people to gain their independence from a slavery war. So during this time, like, all the other great powers had slaves. So when they viewed Haiti, they said, okay, you can have your freedom, but we're gonna slap an embargo on you. So no other country wanted to trade with Haiti. So historically, Haiti has always been isolated. And Haiti's had dictators also. But it's a lot. It's a lot.
Yeah.
When it comes to it.
Right. So basically, you could say that Haiti has been sabotaged from the very beginning.
From the very beginning, exactly.
Because they had the audacity, as some people say, to stand up against their oppressors and free themselves, even though it cost Haiti a lot, because they had to pay back friends. How much was it?
Billions.
Billions
right now.
A lot of money. And didn't they just recently finish paying that, or like within the past?
They paid that in the 1940s.
So, and then you also take into account that Haiti, as well as DR, was occupied by the United States in the early 1900s, right? So it seems that there's always been a lot of meddling in Haiti's affairs, political affairs. And then we take also into account the fact that the Haitian government has proven itself to be very corrupt.
Exactly. I'm not going to blame everything on the outside, because I know during Trujillo, during his occupation of the Dominican Republic, he actually built things. when we had our dictator, Papadoc, mm-hmm. and the only thing he built was the airport. So, I mean, yeah. So, Haitians have to blame themselves also.
Okay. So, one of the big topics, you know, that always gets brought up when people talk about DR in Haiti is the immigration of Haitians to DR, be it illegally and especially illegally. What are your thoughts on that? Because it's a complicated situation because on the one hand, you know that there are a lot of poor Haitians that are they're in survival mode, for real, for real. I can't entirely blame them for either crossing over into DR or trying to go to other islands in search of a better life because of the situation they're living in Haiti. But how do you feel about that and the fact that Haitians, they always find themselves having to flee their own country and go to other countries, and especially in the case of DR, how do you feel about that?
I think it's a sad situation when it comes to Haitians, but I think it's also survival mode because you have, as a human condition, we're always going to want to look for better opportunities. But I think, especially now, I know the assassination is a different question.
Yeah.
But I think now, all eyes are on Haiti.
Yeah.
So right now, the world is looking at Haiti. So maybe, who knows, in the future, this situation be a thing of the past. We'll see.
Yeah. Okay, so that's the next thing I wanted to ask you, because that's been like the big news this week, the assassination of the Haitian president, and now apparently the U.S. government may get involved to try to stabilize the country, which I've seen a lot of posts online. People have their opinions about that, and they're like, oh my God, once the U.S. gets involved, it's a wrap. There's probably some hidden motive behind that. So tell us what you think about the assassination. Do you feel it was an inside job, as some say? And how do you feel about the U.S. possibly getting involved?
The assassination is insane. Every time I look at the story, it just doesn't add up. It doesn't make sense. And personally, I do feel it's an inside job, because how does a president of a country get killed? Especially a president that has his own security. You know what I'm saying? Security cameras. How does that happen?
Yeah.
It has to be inside. And to top that off, Colombians, along with Haitian Americans, did the deed. So how does that happen?
Right. That's what's so interesting. Like, I mean, I've heard people say, oh, it was some drug-related stuff or, like, gang-related stuff. There's a lot of different things I've been seeing online. The involvement of Colombians was very interesting. I made a post the other day on my YouTube community tab, and I was like, yo, I'm just glad it wasn't Dominicans involved, because, you know, I did see some people already trying to say, once they heard there were Spanish speakers, they're like, oh, probably Dominicans, which I was like, why would Dominicans get involved in that? Why would Dominicans contribute to the turmoil in Haiti as if it doesn't directly affect us back?
Exactly.
Like, that makes no sense.
But I will say the president of Haiti involved himself in too many things. And he pissed off too many people. So right now it's hard for, I know they're doing investigations, it's hard for them to pinpoint who would do something like this, because the president had so many enemies. Because they said that he was in charge of gangs, he says that he was in charge of people getting killed. So when you build up a rapport like that, it's hard to find out who killed you.
Yeah.
Since you had so many people that didn't like you.
Yeah. I was also reading that he was supposed to step down a long time ago and he didn't want to. So it seemed like, I don't know, there were a lot of people that were dissatisfied with him also.
It was.
Yeah. Okay. And then as far as the first lady, I remember at first I was reading that she had also been killed, and I posted that on my Instagram stories, but I removed it once I heard that was false. So she's now, she's stable now?
She's stable. And I want to do a shout out to the Dominican Republic, the government, because it was their private jet that helped the first lady get to Florida.
Wow.
So a lot of people don't realize, as much as you hear the hate, there's more positive in the Dominican Republic and Haiti than there anything. And a strong Dominican Republic needs a strong Haiti. Right now, I feel personally, because of Haiti's status, it's harder on the Dominican Republic.
Yeah.
And even the government, I mean, I don't know, the president said that with the president before. Like, a stronger Haiti will help the Dominican Republic, because
of course.
They're the biggest trading partners right now. So
that is true. Haiti is, if not one of the biggest, or it is the biggest trading partner of DR. So you know, despite the historical or current tension among the Dominican and Haitian people, at the end of the day, economically, we are dependent on each other. Because I think you were telling earlier, a lot of the products in Haiti are actually Dominican products. So yeah, they're like, Haiti is literally one of our biggest importers. So it's only in both of our best interests to, at least on a political, economic level, to have a functioning, amicable relationship with one another.
Here's what I say. I feel like, I don't think the country should ever merge.
I agree.
But I feel like they should be this when it comes to business. To further both countries.
Think smarter. Gotta think smarter.
Because Dominican trucks are going across the border all the time with Dominican products in Haiti. So, we're like, who was the person I said that? I think, I forget his name, but he mentioned something. He was like, when it came to black African-Americans and white people, it's like, we came on different ships, but we're on the same boat now. So even though I agree that we're two different countries, we're on the same boat. I think we have a lot more in common than we don't, if that makes sense.
Okay. Well, I agree with what you said, that because the whole merging two countries into one, that's another idea that gets thrown out there, which naturally a lot of people are against. And I also made a video about this in the past, which I think you had commented on, where I was saying I don't think that we should merge into one country, because at the end of the day, we are two separate nations with our own people, our own culture, our own language, our customs, whatever. But we are on the same island. So at the end of the day, it only works in both of our best interests.
Let me cut you off.
Oh, no, go ahead.
But I feel like one day, if Haiti, God willing, ever gets to where Dominican Republic is, are there going to be a special relationship like U.S. and Canada? Yes. But right now, no, because Haiti right now is a mess, let's be honest.
Yeah.
Only God can help Haiti right now. It's ridiculous.
So you think that the U.S. getting involved and helping to stabilize the country, you think that would actually be a good thing?
It depends on how the U.S. gets involved. Because historically, the U.S. has not played a great role helping Haiti.
Yeah.
I know in 94 with President Aristide, the military actually came to help Haiti. They sent troops down because things were rough for him. Mm-hmm. But that didn't do anything. And then they had the Minista, I don't know how to say it in English, the UN, Peace Force, come and help Haiti. And that gave a little bit of peace. But the thing is, when you take advantage of poor people, there was a lot of cases where the UN peacekeeping force were raping the woman. They had kids it was a whole mess. So I think right now, the way to help Haiti is strategically, and I think the Haitian people need to help themselves. Without any involvement from any other government.
So do you feel that the Haitian diaspora, you know, those that have left and either gone to, say, the U.S., France, wherever, do you feel like they're playing an active role in helping Haiti and sending money back and things like that?
The thing about it, when it comes to the diaspora, the Haitian government makes it so hard for the diaspora to help Haiti. Like, I know in Dominican Republic, if you're born in America, right, you have the opportunity to go back. The government makes it more easy. Because I was reading something where it says, retire in Dominican Republic.
Yeah.
So receive your pension monthly living in the Dominican Republic. Mm-hmm. In Haiti, it's the opposite. They make it hard for, let's say I own a multi-million dollar company. It would be hard for me to start a business in Haiti. Because the way the government laws are written, it's different.
Gotcha. And do you see a lot of Haitians sending money back to the family members?
I do. We all do. Okay. I think that's what's keeping Haiti afloat. It's because a lot of the Haitian citizens in Haiti are living by how do you say it?
Remesa. I know the word in Spanish.
Remesa?
I don't know what it is in
Creole.
I understand.
I forget the word in English. They're living by thank you. That's why I say it. So I have a cousin, he'll be like, I need money. $20. But you feel, I can only imagine being in his predicament, like you have to ask for money. You can't go out and work because there's no jobs. The government doesn't offer an opportunity for people to work.
Something else to, I think, kind of bring up is that not all of Haitian migrants are, you know, the super poor migrants we're used to seeing. There is a distinction between the more middle to middle upper class Haitians that kind of leave and go to the U.S., to France, wherever, versus the poor Haitians that we see a lot of times going into DR. And I think that is what has also shaped the perception that a lot of Dominicans have of Haitians, because in DR, of course, you see the poorer ones, which also happen to a lot of times be the blacker ones.
Exactly.
And so people think, you know, oh, Haitians are, they're all just super poor and super black. Not to sound, you know, whatever, but that's a concept, or the concept? Perception?
It's perception.
That's the perception a lot of people have of Haitians, particularly, especially in DR, because that's what you see over there. So we were talking earlier, and you were talking about, like, there is a difference between, like, social structure as far as color and class is concerned. And you do see that a lot of the much poorer people in Haiti tend to be blacker, whereas the more upper class tend to be, you know, lighter skinned, mixed. The 5% that you hear about, which in reality is a, I mean, 5% sounds small, but when you spell out the actual number, it's quite a bit of them.
It's a lot.
And you were saying that in your experience going to Haiti, you saw all these people driving nice cars, owning a lot of businesses. And you told me that you saw a lot of the Arab people in Haiti, that they own a lot of the supermarkets there. So tell us about that and what you, I mean, I already kind of said some of it, but what you observed as far as the class structure in Haiti.
I'm going to start by saying this. It's sad that Haiti is the first black country, but the legacy of slavery and colorism still lives on in everywhere, in every Latin American country. It affects Haiti, because when you look at the 1% ruling Haiti, it's all the light, close to white Haitians that's ruling Haiti. And most of the poor Haitians are the black Haitians. So like Tina was saying, that 5% number, if you spell out that number, it's 500,000 Haitians who are light-skinned. I mean, it's not a lot, it's 5%, but it is a lot. It's 500,000 people. And they're the main ones who are living the life in Haiti. I mean, they have the nice houses, the nice cars. And when I went to Haiti, I remember I was like, let me dress down, let me not wear, you know, expensive jewelry.
Yeah.
But when I went, I seen them wearing their expensive jewelry, the nice clothes, the, you know. When I went, I think Karachi's first came out, right? And I seen a light-skinned, you know, Haitian woman with Karachi's at a restaurant. So, I mean, it's unfair, but these are practices, especially when it comes to slavery, these are things that live on.
Yeah.
Even though Haiti was the first black country to gain its independence, we still didn't gain our independence when it comes to colorism, when it comes to classism.
Yeah.
That stayed.
Yeah. Wow, yeah, that's crazy. And yeah, you were showing me pictures of some of your family members, and I was like, yo, I would think some of them were Dominican. Especially some of like the lighter ones, they definitely, I mean, even you, I even told you, like, to be honest, if I were to see you walking down the street in DR, I would think you were Dominican. No, seriously. I mean, then that just shows that there is some overlap. Even though I know a lot of times, you know, it's painted like DR and Haiti are like night and day, like y'all are just super black and we're like, you know, they're very mixed people, lighter skinned people, but there's definitely some overlap between both populations and the people in your family, like on your mom's side, they definitely show that.
When it comes to black people, because of our history, especially when it comes to black Americans or Brazilians, because we had white slave masters, that made black people to different colors, and that's why they have that term color. So because of that, slave masters, we have all different colors of black people. You have people like me, you have lighter, all considered black. And when America occupied Haiti, they were like, those are French-speaking niggers, because we came in all colors. You can't distinguish. When they came, they couldn't. Everybody just looked like niggers to them, because they couldn't say, oh, light-skinned Haitian or black. There's so many different colors of Haitians.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not as diverse as the Dominican Republic, but we still have the human rainbow when it comes to Haiti also.
Okay. Yeah. You know, I was telling you earlier that for most of my life, Haitian people were always like a mystery to me. Because one, my parents didn't talk about Haitians growing up. Like, I rarely heard my parents speaking about Haitians or anything to do with Haiti in general. So the most interaction I've had with Haitian people has been since I've been on YouTube. And so it's just been very interesting for me learning not just more about Dominican history, but just learning more about Haitian history. And just some of the overlapping history between both sides as well. That's been definitely a very interesting experience for me because, like I was telling you earlier, most of what I knew of Haiti was like the stereotypes that were taught here in the U.S. of voodoo. You know, that's like the primary thing. You learn about Haiti, oh, they practice voodoo over there. And I see articles on Facebook about, oh, zombies in Haiti. And more recently, I hear about mermaids in Haiti and stuff like that. That was like my perception. So I didn't realize that in actuality, for example, most Haitians are Catholic or Christian.
I grew up super ultra Christian.
Yeah.
I went to a Pentecostal church. They looked down on voodoo to the point where I was scared of voodoo. And it wasn't until I went to Haiti, I was like, this is a religion like any other religion. Mm-hmm. But it's a misconception. I don't know when it comes to black. It's always harder for a black person, let's be honest. Mm-hmm. In Hollywood, I know back in the day, they made voodoo look like it was so evil. But in reality, if you look like at voodooism or what the Mexican practice, I forget what it's called, you know, the religion, the honoring your dead people?
Yeah, I don't know the name for it.
Voodoo is the same way, how the Mexicans bring out the food on the Day of the Dead. Mm-hmm. Same thing as voodoo. It's just, I don't know, it's just harder for, I'm going to go back to the skin color. It's always judged differently when it's a black person. In actuality, it's the same thing as what Buddha or what the Mexicans practice. Mm. Honoring your dead.
Yeah. Mm. I don't know too much about voodoo. I mean, I think if I went to a voodoo ceremony, I'd probably be scared.
It is weird. I'm going to be honest. It is. I've seen some things on YouTube. It does look a little weird, you know, with them killing a chicken, sacrifice and shit like that. But I mean, to some people, Christianity and Catholicism might be weird because you're praying to Mother Mary and there's all statues. If you go into a Catholic church, it's weird. So, I mean, whatever you don't know and it's different is always going to be weird.
Right. Fear of the unknown. Yeah. So, you were also telling me earlier that you've been to some resorts in Haiti, right? Mm-hmm. So again, there's a contrast, right? The picture will always paint of Haiti versus what is there in actuality. And I was also telling you, lately I've been having like Haiti vlogs showing up in my recommended on YouTube. So I've watched some, like parts of some of them, and I'm like, wow, Haiti actually, I mean, you have of course the very poor areas, but there's also some very nice like resort areas that look almost like just as nice as the ones in DR. But again, you don't see that side of Haiti very often.
Exactly.
And sometimes I feel like, man, if the Haitian government could get their act together, they could capitalize on the tourism industry the same way DR has, like, I feel like that would help Haiti tremendously. But then again, you know, I hear people say, well, you know, you have to be careful going to Haiti, it's unsafe, people get abducted or kidnapped. So, I don't know, it's just very tough. Because it's like, Haiti has the potential. But when you have the government and stuff that doesn't do shit, it just makes it very difficult.
I remember when I went to Haiti, and some of the Haiti beauty is like untapped natural beauty that's in Haiti.
Yeah.
People don't realize. Like, when you go on Google, I have some homework for you guys who's watching. Don't Google Haiti. Google Haiti beaches, Google Haiti resorts on Google Images, and you'll see what I'm talking about. It's some of the most beautiful, like they said, like Haiti has the longest coastline in the world. So if Haiti gets their act together, God willing, that coastline could be like a resort area, and it'll be the longest resort coastline in the world. But Haiti is a very naturally, it's a damn island. When you think of an island, what do you think of? Haiti is a beautiful country.
Yeah. I think people are kind of scared sometimes. They're kind of scared from going to Haiti, but if people would just, I don't know, maybe give Haiti a chance.
Well, I wouldn't recommend going to Haiti right now.
Well, yeah, not right now.
Let things die out.
Right, right. Yeah, definitely not right now, because it's crazy right now.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, and it's like just protest after protest.
But I will say this. I think if Haiti's not getting the support right now, we should support Dominican Republic. And I have plans of going to Dominican Republic right now. Because I feel like it's one island. If Dominican Republic's doing good, it's good for Haiti. Because believe it or not, Dominicans actually really do support Haiti. Because yes. I know they were the first responders that came out to help Haiti during the 2010 earthquake. And not only that, like I said, they did help. They help Haiti in all kinds of ways. Let's be honest. Even with aid relief, they help.
And I'm glad you're saying that as a Haitian.
Oh, yeah.
Because, again, people online, they love to trash Dominicans and say that, you know, we hate Haitians and that we're so racist towards them, which I'm not going to say there aren't individual Dominicans that can be that way. But for the most part, anytime Haiti has been through some shit, the first people to always respond and aid Haiti is DR. Always. And it's like, that's what kind of pisses me off when people say stuff like that. It's like, yo.
The haters.
Yeah, it's like, yo, DR is always there helping Haiti through everything. And even with all the immigrants coming in, giving Haitians free education, free healthcare. I mean, they're given opportunities in DR that they don't have in Haiti. So it's like, come on, y'all.
I haven't seen a bit on YouTube where before, like back in, I think, 2009, Dominicans had this organization where they would go and help the kids. And I seen a video of these Dominicans dressed up in clowns to go help like little kids.
Oh, really?
So, miss me with the Dominican and Haitian stuff. I think it's a greater picture, and I think for the most part, Dominicans and Haitians get along.
Yeah, I mean, I would say on a bigger scale, yes. I mean, of course, you're always gonna have those individual cases. And you know, there have been cases of Haitians going into the DR and cutting up. Apart from those specific cases, I think for the most part, they live in harmony. I mean, Dominicans aren't bad people, just like Haitians aren't bad people. So, I mean, at the end of the day, like I had actually another Dominican tell me that for the most part, Haitians they go to work and they mind their business. They're not trying to really be beefing with the Dominican in DR, you know?
So, like I always say this, I feel like at the end of the day, I don't think Dominicans want Haitians to be doing bad. Because I think they want Haitians to stay in their own country.
Yes.
And I think a strong Haiti is a strong Dominican Republic.
I agree.
We're on one island.
I agree.
Like I said, I don't believe in merging the island, but I believe there should be a special partnership, just like Canada and Mexico. Canada and US.
Yeah.
And US and Mexico.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah, so I definitely agree with what you said. And you know, I really do hope that moving forward in the future, you know, we can kind of straighten out what's going on the island. Because again, like we've been saying, a strong Haiti is a strong DR, a strong DR is a strong Haiti. So despite all the tension, I mean, we got to look at the bigger picture because we're on the same boat together. So if one side starts sinking, what do you think is going to happen to the other side? We're going to start sinking as well.
John Lewis said, we came in different ships, but we're on the same boat now.
Well, you guys, that was it for this interview. Hope that you guys enjoyed it. Shout out to my haters that I know are watching. I know I'm going to be talking shit because I interviewed a Haitian. Oh, my God. But anyway, F them. So, you guys, please subscribe to Ricardo's channel. I'm going to leave the link to his channel down below. I know you said it's been a while since you've really
been active.
But I'm going to link. Go subscribe anyways. You do have plans to get active on there again.
I think I'm going to do a travel blog, so bear with me. We'll see.
And if you go to DR, you should definitely vlog down there too.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
I want some tostinos. I'm going to vlog that.
All right, y'all. Well, don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Hit the like button, and I'll catch you guys in my next video. Bye.